Okay, so we can continue. So this is part two. And part two is called the double machine learning for causal and treatment effects. This is based, the presentation is based on these two papers. One is forthcoming in Econometrica. It's called Program Evaluation and Causal Inference with High Dimensional Data. Another paper that was recently uploaded to Archiv, it's called the double machine learning for causal treatment effects. So the collaborators on these projects are Denis Chetverikov, Esther Duflo, Christian Hansen, Mer Demirer, Whitney Newey, Alex Biloni, Ivan Fernandez-Val. So what we want to do here is to provide a general framework for estimating and doing inference about a low-dimensional parameter, theta naught. So in part one of the presentation, the low-dimensional parameter was alpha. Now here it becomes theta naught. So we want to do inference on some low-dimensional parameter in the presence of a high-dimensional nuisance parameter, eta naught. And this high-dimensional nuisance parameter will be estimated with a new generation of non-parametric statistical methods called machine learning or branded as machine learning. So examples include random forest, boosted trees, lasso, ridge, deep and standard neural nets, gradient boosting, the aggregations of the methods and cross hybrids. You could have aggregations, like for example, you could aggregate the predictions from random forest and lasso, or you could do cross hybrids. For example, you could take out a polynomial trend by lasso and then fit the random forest to the residual. That would be an example of a hybrid method, something that people can do in practice very easily. The question is how to do theory with those things, hybrid things. So here's a graphical illustration of what the machine learning is about. It's a branding. I mean, actually, I guess originally machine learning was statistics that was done in computer science departments. A lot of these techniques were not invented by, I mean, they were just invented by statisticians, like, for example, random forest lasso ridge, also invented by in SAS departments. I think only boosting was invented, like, in computer science or something like this. All other techniques are not computer scientists are not responsible for those techniques. Nonetheless, I now called machine learning for the lack of better word. And so to me, it's just a new generation of non-parametric statistical methods. Like they're a lot more flexible than the previous generation. So it's good to have them. It's good to work with them. So in this work, what we try to do, we try to build upon and extend the classical work in semi-parametric estimation, which also focused on inference about low dimensional parameter in presence of high dimensional nuisance parameters. So there's a lot of work starting with Bickel in the 80s. There's quite a bit of work in econometrics, Andrew Slinton, Newey, Robinson, Rutnitsky, van der Waart, van der Laan and Rubin, and many others. So what they do basically, like a lot of these, actually all of these references, they do rely on traditional non-parametric methods for estimating eta naught. In particular, they impose that these estimators of these high-dimensional nuisance parameters lie in the so-called Donsker set. This is actually an autocorrect spelling error. Like it's supposed to be Donsker set here. It says denser set because it autocorrected me. The machine incorrectly corrected me. So this assumption actually rules out the assumptions, the traditional assumptions in the semi-parametric rules out. They basically rule out like most of these techniques, because realizations of these estimators will not lie in general in Donsker sets. Donsker sets are entropically simple sets. The realizations of these estimators will lie in sets whose entropy is increasing with the sample size. So the traditional semi-parametric theory does not apply. So we have to do something else. We have to work around that. So what we're doing here is a continuation of work. So So there's a bit of work on using lasso type methods, but there's very, very little work on using other machine learning type of methods. And so what we do here, we try to push this forward. And today I'll try to make two main points. I guess one will be negative and another one will be positive. The negative point will be that the machine learning methods, they seem to be remarkably effective in prediction context. However, good predictive performance does not necessarily translate into performance for estimation and inference about low dimensional causal parameters, right? In fact, the performance can be poor. Okay. So good prediction does not imply that you get good inference for some low dimensional target parameters automatically. And the second point will be positive is that, well, by doing double machine learning or orthogonalized machine learning and sample splitting, we can construct high quality point and interval estimates for causal parameters. So by doing additional machine learning, by solving our auxiliary prediction problems, we can actually do a good job at causal inference. So I'll be using a partially linear model as a running example. It connects naturally to my first part of the talk. We have the outcome variable, y. We have the treatment variable here, the policy or treatment variable whose coefficient we would like to estimate. Z here are going to be high dimensional covariates called controls or confounders. And Z here appear via complicated function, g naught of Z. So this is some non-parametric function that we would like to learn. Previously we used high dimensional linear approximations to this function. Here we abandon this linear framework and just work with g naught of Z, okay? And then there's a regression error u. The conditional expectation of u given z and d is equal to zero. So this is called partially linear model because this model is partially linear with respect to the variable of interest. I'll mention extension to non-separable models towards the end of the talk, as well as to moment condition models. In the middle of the talk. So anyway, so this is going to be the running example. And Z here are going to be confounders in the sense that D and Z are going to be related. Just like before, we have a relation between the target variable or treatment variable and the controls. So D is going to be equal to M0 of Z plus V. V is another regression error here. And this function M0 here is not going to be equal to zero, as is typically the case in observational studies. If you have a randomized control trial, if it's a proper randomized control trial, M0 is supposed to be equal to zero. But typically in observational studies, you don't have M0 equal to zero. And also, you could have randomized control trials that are actually not proper randomized control trials. Sometimes you're not aware of that, so you could have violations you could have confounding going on, and so this M0 will not in general be equal to zero here. Okay, so this is our partial linear model, and suppose we try to use machine learning techniques for estimating this regression function here. So I could even do this by respecting this functional form. So here's an example. Suppose I want to predict y using d and z, respecting this functional form, and I can obtain this estimate g hat naught by say like random forest. I could also use neural nets, something like this, or you know any of you like boosted trees, any of your favorite machine learning techniques. So for example, to be concrete, I can obtain an estimate of this regression function that actually that respects the partial linearity here. How can I do this? Well, I can obtain this estimate by doing alternating minimization. So I could guess a parameter, initial parameter value for theta naught, say zero. Then I could run a random forest regression of y minus d theta hat naught on z, get an initial fitted value for g naught z. Then I take out this fitted value from y and regress it on d to update the estimate of theta naught. I repeat until convergence. That's going to be an alternating minimization algorithm that gets me an estimate of this theta naught. Okay. So this is a this will be like a random forest algorithm that gets me a good estimate of the regression function. It will work beautifully for prediction purposes. It will predict y very well. Like the random forest is one of the most successful prediction techniques used in the industry quite a bit. But if we look at the, if we're interested in theta naught here, this estimate that we get here, theta hat naught, is not going to be so good. So in particular, if we look at the histogram, the finite sample distribution of this estimate, theta hat naught, it's not going to be centered very well. It's going to be biased. And not so here, the, like in this Monte Carlo experiment that I have here, the truth is zero. The estimate is centered around minus 0.3. It bounces between minus 0.2 and minus 0.4. And in the experiment, actually, I really set up the experiment such that G naught is very well approximated by a random forest. So G naught, the true G naught is given by a linear combination of regression trees. So random forest is supposed to be really working well, and it really works well for prediction, but it doesn't work so well for inference about the slow dimensional parameter. So why is this? Well, basically, to have excellent predictive performance, what's going on is that this estimate is regularized. Like in the high dimensional settings, this will be regularized, kind of pressed down towards zero a bit. And this forces something like omitted variable bias you've seen in the part one. So this regularization bias translates into this estimate being biased and not centered around the true estimate. And we will develop some intuition for why this is the case. This will speak maybe to the first part of the talk a bit. So here I mentioned this random forest. Some of you may be familiar with it, some of you may not be familiar, but just a quick reminder of what this is. So so this is just a quick background. So random forest is a linear combination of regression trees. You build each regression tree on a bootstrap sample. Each tree represents is created by a recursive binary partitioning of the regression space into beans, and in each bean you use a local average to form a prediction of the outcome variable. It's one of the most successful machine learning techniques. Why is it successful? Because of this binary partitioning procedure. It really uses the memory effectively. It's really like a great practical tool, and it also has been documented to work well like, for predictive performance and so on. Now, so it's a linear combination of regression trees. Regression trees are more basic objects. Like in case you don't know what regression trees are, here's a 2-minute. 1-minute introduction to regression trees. So you try to figure out the splitting of the regressor space into beans, and you do it in a recursive way. You first figure out a variable and a splitting point for this variable that gives you the best improvement in fit. Then you cut the space into two parts, not necessarily equal parts, and then you repeat. Then you got the two new parts, and then you work with each part, and you work down. So here's an example where you try to predict the wages using education, experience, and other characteristics. It turns out whether or not, for the US data, whether or not you have a college degree is the first most important predictor. It's a binary one. The second most important is the experience. So for example, if you're a college graduate, so the college would be equal to 1. And if you have experience greater than 10 years, the prediction of the hourly wage will be $24 an hour. If experience is less than 9.5, then the predicted wage would be $17 an hour. If you're not college graduate, the predicted wages will be a lot lower. So this is an example where you created four beans by figuring out the splits. Like this is the first split, this is the second split. This is an example of a regression tree of depth two. Okay? And there's a whole art associated with how you build the trees and how you prune the trees, like how you do the model selection on trees and how you combine the trees into random forests. Okay, so there's a, I cannot do justice here in just 1 or 2 minutes, but it gives you some rough idea of what this is, what this technique is about. To me, these details are not going to be important. Everything that I'll talk about will be true for a lot of these techniques. Okay, all I need from these techniques is that good predictive performance. I don't care about the particular structure of those techniques, so it's not important to me what the fine details of those techniques are. So the procedure that I'll talk about will be agnostic about the nature of the machine learning techniques. Okay. All right, so this is a negative point. So we say, okay, so this naive machine learning is good for prediction, but it's not necessarily good if you try to get good causal estimates. So for example, if you do demand analysis and you do and D is like price, and you're interested in an elasticity parameter, yeah, you could get good prediction for quantities demanded, but you may not get actually good estimates of the elasticity, right? From these techniques, you could actually do a better job with something else. What is this something else? It's going to be this double machine learning approach. It's going to be the positive points. So here, so how does this double machine learning work here? So we will solve two prediction problems as opposed to one. So we will predict outcome variable as well as the treatment variable using controls Z. We will denote the predictions by hatted quantities. So this is expected value of Y Z, given Z with a hat on top. Expected value of D given Z with a hat on top. We can use random forest here, or we can use any other best performing machine learning tools. Like sometimes whatever works for a given data set, you can actually test what works for the given data set by using sample splitting. You can pick the best machine you like. You do this prediction, and then you residualize. You take Y, you subtract off the predicted value. You take D, you subtract off the predicted value. You get these residuals, and then what you do, you regress one residual on the other, and this is going to be the machine learning version of the Frisch-Wahl-Lavelle partialing out method, something that I already mentioned in the context of Lasso. And now, if you look at this distribution of this machine learning, the post-double machine learning estimator for the this low-dimensional parameter, it will be correctly centered. It will be correctly centered, and the shape of the distribution will be approximately Gaussian. Actually, the risk of this estimator is going to be lower than the risk of this estimator, because the variance of this estimator is lower, but the bias is so big that it dominates the risk comparisons. So this is higher variance estimator, but it has a lot lower bias. And so you can also do inference and confidence bands with this estimator. Okay, so two different uses of machine learning. So here we would, if we're interested in prediction, this would be a good way to go. If we're interested in this parameter theta naught, I'm going to argue that this is a better way to do it. Okay. So these two strategies that I described, they rely on two very different moment conditions that identify the parameter of interest, theta naught. The first strategy, the naive strategy, is called the regression adjustment strategy, and it's based on working with this moment condition where we have expected value of y minus d theta naught minus g naught of z times d equal to 0. So this is like an obvious moment condition that one could use for identifying theta naught once you know the g naught, right? And the second strategy that I described, so this is a regression adjustment strategy, and the second strategy that I described, the partialing out strategy, is based on working with residualized quantities. You take y, subtract off the predicted value, take the d, subtract off the predicted value, times theta naught, and then times, so here you also residualize the d. Okay. So we'll call this Niemann orthogonal moment condition. Turns out that this is the gives you a semi-parametrically efficient way for estimating theta naught under homoscedasticity. There is also another strategy which is called propensity score adjustment here. I'm not going to be mentioning the strategy, but it will not work so well. Just like regression adjustment, it will not work so well because it will not have the orthogonality structure. So in both approach one and the second approach that works with this moment condition three, they generate estimators of theta naught by solving the empirical analogs of these moment equations. So you would replace these expectations by the empirical expectations, and instead of these unknown nuisance parameters, G naught, and these conditional expectations here, you would plug in the machine learning-based estimators of those quantities. So instead of G naught, M naught, and L naught, you would have the hatted quantities. So here, M naught of Z is gonna be denoting the conditional expectation of D given Z. Sometimes it's called the propensity score in the context, in the cases where D is binary, okay? And this L naught, the function L naught is gonna be denoting the conditional expectation of Y given Z. So the both of the estimators, they solve the empirical analogs of these equations after we plug in for the unknown nuisance parameters. So we replace those parameters by the estimators. So let's look at in detail at the first strategy, like what's going on here. Why do we get this behavior? So if we look at the first strategy, we can write down the estimator for in closed form here at theta hat naught. It's just a least squares estimator. So what we're doing here, we're taking yi, subtract off the g hat of zi, and then you're regressing this on di, right? So this is just the least squares formula. And then you can, with a little bit of algebra, you can rewrite this estimator minus the target times root n as the sum of two terms, a and b. A is going to be this good term. It's going to be approximately Gaussian and centered at zero. So it's going to be very well behaved. But what about the term b? It has this estimation error in it. Actually, the term b, it's the biased term, and the claim will be is that this biased term actually generically diverges off to infinity, so that the estimator is actually not root n consistent. So there's too much bias in this procedure. So why is this? Well, heuristically, if you do back of envelope calculations, if you look at this expression here, you can further approximate it by this expression. So you have here the summation over I di times this estimation error. Di you can replace by the expectation conditional on Z, so it's gonna be M naught of Zi. So this is not equal to zero under confounding. And this is estimation error here. So there is a, we have n of these terms here. We're dividing by root n. Division by root n helps, but doesn't help too much because still we're summing n terms here. So in general, what's going to be happening here is that the this is the estimation error for estimating g naught. The error is going to be of order n into the power of minus phi. Because we're in the non-parametric settings, the rate of convergence here is going to be slower than the parametric rate. So the rate of convergence is going to be n into the power of minus phi, where phi is going to be strictly between 0 and 1 half. And so this this term will scale like root n times n into the power of minus phi, and it will generically diverge. So this term will diverge. So what does this mean? So this means that, well, this estimator is actually a decent estimator. It's not a bad estimator. It's a decent estimator. But it's not root n consistent, because after we rescale it by root n, it diverges. So it cannot be root n consistent. So yeah, it converges to the truth, but slower than we would like. And so this is why you see this picture that you see here. There's too much bias. The estimator gets pushed to the side. This is what's going on. Now, what happens if we look at the second estimation strategy? So here we'll work with residualized quantities. You have W hat and V hat. And we're regressing the W hat ice on V hat ice. So it's just the least squares formula, right? So we can also rewrite this estimator minus the target times root n as a sum of several terms. So there's going to be three terms, actually, A star, B star, plus a third term here. Okay. So A star is going to be very well behaved. It's going to be, well, it's a sum of centered independent terms. It's going to be approximately Gaussian under standard conditions. This is a bias term. The bias is still there. The bias is still there, but the bias has different structure. And there is another term which I'll talk about later. So if we look at the bias now, it has the product of two estimation errors, which is good news, because previously we had one estimation error times non-zero quantity, but now we get the product of two estimation errors, both of which go to zero. So this is good news, because this is potentially smaller term than what we had before, right? So the B star now depends on the product of estimation errors in both of the nuisance functions. So it will generally scale like root n times n into the power of minus phi m plus phi l, where these are the rates of convergence of estimators of this functions m and l. And in general, you could have the rates that are slower than the parametric rates, but you could have rates of convergence that are quicker than the n into the power of minus 1 over 4. So some slow rates, but fast enough to make this whole term disappear. So you'd have root n times times the product times the square of this. It will go to 0. So the double, so you could argue from this that the double, from this heuristical explanation, that the double machine learning estimator theta hat naught is going to be root n consistent and approximately centered normal. So if we look at this Monte Carlo experiment that we've seen, it seems to confirm this heuristic explanation. So we do see something like this happening. So the bias is small, the estimator is approximately normally distributed. It's a good estimator for the causal parameter. Now, I talked only about these two terms, A star and B star. Now I want to mention what happens to this third term. And now it's basically, what I want to say now is that my discussion will get quite technical for the next 15 or 20 minutes. So maybe if you got the rough picture from what I talked about up to this point, I think it's fine. You did a good job, so you can sit back and relax. What follows next is going to be a bit technical, but the pain will be over like in 15 minutes, and then I'll talk about like empirical example. Okay. Now the third term is of little order one, and in order to have this third term to be of little order one, so which means like it's stochastically vanishing, it's a quantity that converges in probability to zero, we do rely on sample splitting. It means that we use sample splitting. We have main sample, we have auxiliary sample. We use auxiliary sample to do the fitting of these nuisance parameters, and we use the main sample to estimate the main parameters. This potentially involves the loss of efficiency. I'll talk about it later. I'll actually say that we can avoid this loss of efficiency. How? I'll explain how. But right now, we need the sample splitting. And what sample splitting does, it allows us to cover a wide variety of machine learning estimators with the only requirement is that they have fast enough rate of convergence for the target nuisance parameters. So as long as they have faster than this rate of convergence, we are in business, and we can use any of the machine learning estimators you like, even the hybrid ones, as long as they work better than the standard ones, right? So what this condition does, it evolves, it kind of eliminates the conditions on the entropic complexity of the realizations of the machine learning estimators. So what do I mean by this? So if we look at the third term, here, it contains expressions like this. Like this is one of the expressions. It also has analogous other expressions. So what is this term? It's a product of a regression error with an estimation error. This is a centered error. This is estimation error, something that goes to zero. Now, if this regression function was estimated on the auxiliary sample, not on the main sample, this estimation error and this error are independent. And so if m hat goes to m naught, it's very easy to show by using just very primitive tools like Chebyshev inequality. It's very easy to show that this term will be stochastically vanishing. Without sample splitting, if we mix the main sample with the auxiliary sample, and if m hat and ui become dependent, it becomes very hard job to show that this term is of little order one. We do have to rely on the particular structure of the machine learning estimator. So for example, for lasso, we have to rely on sparsity. We have to rely that the solutions of the lasso problem, they are sparse, and we have to carefully control the complexity of the realizations of the estimators, and do careful analysis. And in principle, this analysis has to be done for each machine learning estimator. Like every time you write down a new machine learning estimator, you have to show that the complexity, the entropy complexity, does not increase too much. As the sample size grows, you have to do careful analytical work. So all of this is avoided by doing sample splitting, like very, very simple device. If you're interested in results without sample splitting and all the details, they're quite nasty. The details are very... details are not so nice, and but we did them anyway without sample splitting. It's in this econometrica paper. With sample splitting, it's a lot simpler. So what's okay? So here's one of the painful parts. So without sample splitting, we need to control terms like this. So we have ui times the m naught minus m. We take the supremum over m, living in a set script mn, where the set script mn contains the realizations of the estimators with the probability going to 1. And the entropy in this high-dimensional applications, modern rich data applications, the entropy, the complexity of the set will be increasing with the sample size. So what's the entropy? Very quickly, it's a logarithm of the covering number that you need to cover the set. So it measures the complexity of the set. In particular, the fact that the entropy or the complexity of the sets grows rules out the traditional assumption that the traditional semi-parametric literature has made, that this set is p-Donsker. P-Donsker means that, well, at the minimum, complexity doesn't grow with the sample size. So you need maximal inequalities to control quantities like this. It's a pain to do so, and so you need very careful analysis. All of this is avoided by doing sample splitting. The beauty of sample splitting. So this is the first thing that machine learners do, and this is the to just split the sample in the test validations. First, the very first line of the code, split the sample into two parts, right? Maybe even three parts. So all of this is avoided, okay? And once this is done, then the only technical conditions, they become like rate conditions, okay? Okay, sample splitting. All right, so now let's go back to, so now we have two techniques, one works and one doesn't work. So we mentioned sample splitting. We could use sample splitting for both, but what fundamentally distinguishes the technique that is based on this equation and on this equation is the structure of these equations, right? So it turns out that this moment condition has this Niemann orthogonality structure, which intuitively means like it has reduced sensitivity with respect to the nuisance parameter. So what do I mean by this? So if we look at the moment condition for the second strategy, if we look at the nuisance parameter, so the nuisance parameter here is these two regression functions. These are high-dimensional nuisance parameters. One way to assess the sensitivity of this moment condition with respect to these parameters is to, well, compute the first derivative with respect to these parameters. If these were finite dimensional parameters, yes, this will be just the first derivative. These are infinite dimensional parameters, so there's a generalization of the derivative called the directional derivative or Gateau derivative, right? So the Gateau derivative operator of the moment condition 3 with respect to this nuisance parameter actually vanishes at when evaluated at the true value. So it means that this moment condition, it remains valid under local mistakes in the nuisance functions. So it has reduced sensitivity with respect to perturbations of the nuisance parameters, which is good because in practice, empirically, we will work with the empirical analog of this equation. We will plug in, we will not know the true nuisance parameters. We will plug in the estimates. And now we work with a moment condition that has a reduced sensitivity with respect to this nuisance parameter. So the first derivatives vanishes. There's no first order effect from estimation of these nuisance parameters. So this is Niemann orthogonality. We call this Niemann orthogonality because Niemann was, to the best of our knowledge, was the first who used this property in the 50s when he was setting up his Niemann test, the C-alpha test. So he argued that this is a good property to have in the parametric settings. He developed this machinery and argued that this is a good property, and so we call this Niemann orthogonality property. And so the second strategy based on partitioning out actually implicitly creates this moment condition that has this Neeman orthogonality, right? And this is going to be the key to the generalization. Now, if we look at this in sharp contrast, this property, the Neeman orthogonality property, does not hold for the first strategy. It does not hold for the moment condition. One that was used for estimating theta naught. Right? So this is the key property that we would like to have. Plus sample splitting is another thing. Okay, so now we realize through this running example, okay, so this is what we need. We need this structure, the orthogonality structure, Neeman orthogonality structure, plus we need sample splitting, plus we need good rates of convergence for the nuisance parameters, and we can do generalization, right? So we can provide general results for moment condition models. So here's our moment condition model. We have an expectation of psi of w theta naught eta naught equal to zero. This could be vector valued moment conditions. This psi, we will call this the score function. Theta naught here is going to be a low dimensional parameter. Eta naught is going to be nuisance parameter that lives in some abstract convex set. Here's a formal definition of the Neeman orthogonality here. So we define this Gateau derivative. You set up some deviations away from the true nuisance parameter. This is the direction. This is amount by which you deviate. You take the derivative with respect to this scalar parameter r. You compute this derivative at zero. So this derivative is indexed by the directions. So it's an operator. And what you require is that this derivative vanishes for all the directions. Right? So this is the formal definition. Again, heuristically, it means that small deviations and nuisance functions, they don't invalidate the moment conditions. So this is just a directional derivative or Gateau derivative. Right? Sometimes it's also called pathwise derivative, depending on the background that you have. Okay, so this is key ingredient we require. Of course, yeah, we require this ingredient, but the question is how do you actually build the score functions that are Neeman orthogonal? And we have a sequence of worked out examples. We have a machinery for building these orthogonal score functions. In this partially linear models that I described, you do this by partitioning out. In some other models, there are good ways of building the score functions. I'll mention briefly some of them. Another key ingredient is sample splitting. For sample splitting, formally it works like this. So we have integers 1 through capital N. That's going to be set of all observations. I is going to denote the main sample. It's the set of observation numbers of size little n that will be used to estimate theta naught. I complement is going to be the auxiliary sample or set of observations of size capital N minus little n that will be used to estimate the nuisance parameter. And the main and the auxiliary sample, they form a random partition of this full sample. So you do the random split of the sample into the main and the auxiliary part. And the sample splitting simplifies the analysis a lot. Okay, so what follows next is going to be just a bunch of boring regularity conditions that I'm not going to go over because they're going to be mostly familiar to econometricians and completely unfamiliar to non-econometricians. So it's probably safe to skip the discussion here. So this is just a formal statement of the bunch of regularity conditions. They boil down to reasonable smoothness conditions on the score functions. They roll out a parameter on the boundary cases, you know, some pathological cases. There are requirements on the rate of convergence for the nuisance parameters. And So finally, we look at the the double machine learning estimator, theta hat not check. It's formally it's indexed by this by the main sample and the auxiliary sample. So this piece of notation is important here, and this estimator is defined as the empirical analog of the population moment condition. So basically, you choose this estimator to set this quantity to zero as close to zero as possible. This is the empirical expectation over the main sample. So just this is the empirical average taken over the main sample. You plug in for the unknown nuisance parameter here, and you try to set this close to zero as possible. Because the analysis is general, in principle, it allows for the non-smooth score functions here. So formally, you try to set this quantity as close to zero as possible within the numerical tolerance parameter. So this basically, this is just for the sake of generality here. Okay, so this is, the notation is a bit complicated here. But it does allow for non-smooth scores, for non-smooth score functions arising, for example, in median regression problems like that. So and then so now this is probably complete the most general versions of the version of the results that you've seen. This double machine learning estimator is going to be under the assumption state is going to be approximately linear. So it's to the first order is going to be after rescaling is going to be represented by the sum of this influence functions psi bar expressed like this plus a vanishing term, and this this will after rescaling this will have a approximately Gaussian behavior with a mean at zero. Right, so good behavior. So basically, this is a regular estimator, approximately linear, approximately Gaussian, very well-behaved estimator. Now, I mentioned loss of efficiency resulting from the use of splitting. Like we split things in auxiliary and the main. We took the full sample, split it in the auxiliary and in the main part, because we only use a part of the sample to estimate the parameters theta naught. It's not a fully efficient estimator, right? So we're losing some efficiency. And one could say, yeah, maybe it's fine, right? Especially like if we don't believe in correct specification, it's probably fine, right? Like, yeah, we lost some efficiency, but so what? If we do believe in correct specification, yeah, we can actually restore the full efficiency by realizing that, well, actually this splitting that we did gives us an opportunity to get two sets of estimates, right? Because we can flip the roles of the auxiliary and main sample, like repeat the exercise, and then we can get another estimate of the main effect. So we can do 50-50 split of the full sample into our main sample and auxiliary sample, get the first estimate, then reverse the role of the main and auxiliary samples, get another estimate, and take the average of the two estimates, and that's going to gain full efficiency. So there's you can do this simple trick to restore the full efficiency. And obviously this generalizes to something called K-way split. You can generalize this 50-50 split to other splitting schemes. So there's sample splitting is good because it allows us to simplify the analysis enormously. Also, it doesn't entail the efficiency loss if you do this trick here. At least there is no first order efficiency loss. So this is good news. Right? So I have two more minutes of pain, and then there will be an empirical example. Okay. So I wanted to briefly mention how we build orthogonal scores. And the classical construction in the parametric settings goes back to Neeman. So in the parametric likelihood case, what you have is that the log likelihood function is going to be denoted by L W theta beta. Theta is the parameter of interest. beta is a nuisance parameter that you don't care about, and that the true parameter values will satisfy these first order conditions. And what happens is that the natural score for the main parameter will not necessarily have the Neeman structure. It will not have the orthogonality property. But we can always create a different score, which is not going to be equal to this original score, that will have the orthogonality property. How do we do this? Well, we take this score and then subtract off mu times the score with respect to the nuisance parameter, and you could pick this mu parameter such that this derivative vanishes. Okay, you just need to solve some linear equation to figure out what makes the orthogonality condition hold. Okay, so you can basically combine. You can always take the original scores and create a new score that has the orthogonality property, right? So this is good news. Actually, this does generalize. If you are an expert in the semi-parametric estimation, if you're an econometrician, you would know that this generalizes. And you can always take the score or moment function that identifies the parameter, projected onto the orthocomplement of the tangent space induced by the nuisance function. That's a standard construction, and that gives you the score that has the orthogonality property. Okay, the pain is over. So here are a couple of examples. So we have a sequence of worked out examples. Example one was the partially linear example that I presented. This is the orthogonal score, the nice score that you could use. So this is a partially linear model, and here's a generalization to a model that is not partially linear. So assume that treatment is binary, which is going to be relevant for our empirical example, and now we can write y equals to g naught d comma z plus regression error. There are no restrictions on this function g naught anymore. So there's no partially linear restriction anymore. And we could be interested in the so-called average treatment effect. What's the average treatment effect? It's a parameter theta naught, which is given by the expectation over g naught 1 comma z minus g naught comma g naught of 0 comma z. So this is basically conditional treatment effect, and you averaging over the values of z. So this is the average effect. There is also a related parameter called average treatment effect for the treated, where you condition on the subpopulation of the treated. So this is more general than this example, in that we no longer insist on this partially linear structure. It's less general because we now say that the treatment is binary or at least discrete. Okay. So this gives us a parameter of interest, and it's not a problem to write down the orthogonal scores for this parameter or this parameter. Here's the orthogonal score for the average treatment effect parameter. It involves these three regression functions. The g naught of 0 comma z, g naught of 1 comma z, m naught of z. So this is the propensity score, and these are the two regression functions of y given z conditional on d equal to 0 and 1. So we have three nuisance functions, and the orthogonal score here, it combines both the regression function and the propensity score reweighting to construct the estimate of the average treatment effect. So this is also actually the doubly robust score for the estimating, so-called doubly robust score for estimating theta naught. And so there's a bunch of these examples that are worked out, and they all have the structure that the score identifies the parameter of interest, and the derivative with respect to the nuisance parameter vanishes. So this is good structure to have, Neeman structure, and the estimation proceeds the way I described. We estimate these nuisance functions by using machine learning methods. We look at the empirical analogs of the moment conditions. We solve the double machine learning estimated theta hat not check solves this empirical analog of the moment equations, where we have plugged in for the unknown nuisance parameters. It's a very, very, common structure to all of these examples. And there are a bunch of other examples that we have worked out. Here's an empirical example, finally. So in this empirical example, we look at the impact of 401k, which is the private pension plan in the United States, on savings, people's savings, okay? And what we would like to do here is to use the modern machine learning techniques to estimate the impact of 401k eligibility on savings in presence of confounding factors, okay? So why here the outcome variable will be the total financial assets or total wealth? Financial assets or total wealth. The results are not different from, for these two measures. D here is going to be the indicator of working at a firm that offers a 401k pension plan. Not all companies offer the plan. Some offer, some don't. Z here includes the confounding factors such as age, income, family size, education, and a bunch of other variables. And this analysis is based on the original studies that Jim Poterba and Alberto Abadi have done a while ago. They used conventional methods, like least squares method, to do the analysis. So controlling for confounding factors here is important because the 401k pension plans, they are mostly offered by firms tending to employ workers from middle or above the middle class, right? So if you don't control for these confounding factors, you would mechanically get, like if you just run the regression of Y on D, you would mechanically get that 401k raises savings because, well, higher income people tend to work for companies that offer 401k, so that you will get higher savings for the sample of workers that work at firms that offer 401k. So we need to control for income and other confounding factors, right? So after controlling for these confounding factors, it is believed that this the 401k eligibility is plausibly exogenous. So we could treat variation in D as plausibly exogenous, conditional on Z, and so we could interpret the estimation result as causal. And this was an argument made in the original study by Poterba, Venti, and Weiss. Okay, I'm not going to repeat their arguments because I'm not a lawyer. So So here are the estimation results. Here we have estimates of the average treatment effects of the 401k eligibility on net financial assets. The results for total wealth are similar. We estimate two models, the partially linear one that I talked about, and also the interactive model, the non-separable model that I mentioned, the completely non-separable model, the general one. Because here the treatment is binary, 0 or 1, we can actually estimate this average treatment effect in this non-separable model as well. The results are actually not going to be that different, partially linear model versus the interactive model. And we consider using some of the best machine learning techniques. So we consider using random forests, boosted trees, a neural network, single-layer neural network here, as well as the post-lasso estimator. And here, the results that you see. So with random forest, you get the estimate of $1,845 with a standard error of 1,300. Right, so this is the result for the random forest. This is, you use random forest to estimate the nuisance functions, right? So we, remember, we're doing two rounds of machine learning. We're predicting Y and we're predicting treatment. And in both of those steps, we use random forest. These are the estimates that we get. We get similar results using Lasso. Like for Lasso, what we do, we take these controls. We take polynomial transformations of those controls and take interactions. So we use flexible linear model, and we chop down the size of the model by using Lasso. Again, we're doing two rounds of predictions. We're predicting the outcome, and we're predicting the treatment. Boosted trees is another popular technique that people use in practice. In the industry, it's also used a lot. You also get similar numbers. In fact, actually, all of these techniques, they work very similarly. They work very similarly for prediction. Okay, if you properly set them up, they do a very similar job. You also get similar results for the neural nets. And so, yeah, these are the numbers. And it's kind of a good news that all these estimates are within the ballpark of each other. Like, you get very similar conclusions from using any of those techniques. You could also run a horse race between those techniques, because we're using here sample splitting. You can actually see which one works better. It turns out that for predicting Y, Lasso works very well. But for predicting treatment, actually, neural net works very well. So you actually have different machine learning tools working better for different parts of the model. Okay, and so if you use the best machine learning techniques for different parts of the model, this is the estimates that you get. Still similar to the other ones. And here are the estimates for the average treatment effect. So here you need, for the interactive model. So here you need to estimate the regression functions as well as the propensity scores. Again, we can use the random forest, lasso trees, neural nets, and the best machine learning methods, combine these estimates using these orthogonal score functions to build the estimates of the average treatment effects. These are the estimates that we get, and the standard errors that we get are shown in this bracketed expressions. So very similar, very robust conclusions. So this is techniques shown in action. It works. It's all practical, and it's theoretically justified under fairly mild conditions. So let me conclude. So we provided here a set of results that allow root and consistent estimation and provably valid asymptotic inference for causal parameters using a wide class of flexible non-parametric methods called machine learning methods for fitting the nuisance parameters. The construction is based on three key elements. The element number one is the use of Neeman orthogonal scores in forming the estimating equations. We need fast enough convergence rates for estimators of nuisance quantities. And we also need to rely on sample splitting. Okay, so sample splitting really simplifies the analysis and allows this wide coverage of the machine learning methods without diving into the details or particular structure of those estimators. Okay, so.
Now I know I borrowed a couple of pages from your presentation. As luck would have it, it was your first two pages that I used of today's presentation. I had no idea you'd be using the same things.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So thanks for that. A few comments, one question implicit in what I'm going to say. The treatment effect setup, you need two assumptions. One is unconfoundedness. Mm-hmm. The other is common support. So the, so the good news with a lot of indicators is that, in fact, it reinforces the possibility that unconfoundedness would hold.
That's right.
So that's nice. Makes it more credible.
Yes.
The common support, on the other hand, begins to become problematic. So if I had two characteristics of the individuals in my set, it would be a lot easier to assume common support. Once I have many dimensions to characterize individuals, say 150, I'm almost identifying each individual uniquely, and the idea of having common support becomes a bit more difficult, doesn't it? Just think in terms of matching that is implicit.
That's right, yeah. So I'm thinking this in terms of propensity scores bounded away from 0 and 1. Mm-hmm. So it's true, yeah, that by conditioning on more and more, we potentially make the propensity score vary over a wider mm-hmm. region.
And you may not come across it in practice because, as you commented, the penalization is getting rid of a lot of those X's. So you start with a lot of X's.
That's right.
But yeah. They're thrown out.
Right? Yeah.
On that, I have, this is more inviting of reflection on your part. So I'm trying to think, what is it about this situation that requires me not just to purge the X's, not purge just the D from the X's, but I have to purge the Y's. We know we don't have to do that in linear regression when you're not penalizing, right? Mm-hmm. In the 80s, I had a ridge regression estimator with three-stage least squares, mm-hmm. and I played a trick with it. My ridge factor has an order of magnitude that made it vanish with the sample size. Mm-hmm. So I asymptotically got three-stage least squares. Mm-hmm. What if you make the penalization the tuning parameter to have an order of magnitude that goes to zero with the sample size, right?
Yeah, so that's a great comment. So there are actually two comments that I would like to respond. One is that why do we do double partialing out as opposed to single partialing out, something like this, right? In this context here, so we have these three-moment equations. So there are theta naught, the true parameter here, solves each of these equations. So there are three ways of getting to the theta naught. Each of the ways is valid. So each of the ways is valid for identification. But the inferential properties of the methods are all different. So this method has no partialing out. In this method, you do single partialing out. But this is not enough to create a Neumann structure. So this is still good for identification, but it's not enough to create a Neumann structure. And this full partialing out is enough to create a Neumann structure. The score becomes protected against the nuisance parameters. So like in least squares, if you just did single partialing out, just forget about the high dimensional setup. If you did just a single partialing out, you remove the part of D that is explained by Z. The least squares estimate would have nice properties. But you would not be able to use the standard errors that you get from regressing this on this. But after you partial out both the y and z, you can actually use the standard errors, and this is like the unknown part of the Frisch-Wallovell theorem. I mean, it's not a part of Frisch-Wallovell theorem. I mean, I teach it as a second theorem that follows after Frisch-Wallovell, but it's something that people actually don't know commonly. So that's one. Another comment is about what if we make the penalization vanish, the penalty level vanish at a faster rate. And indeed, it's possible in the moderately high-dimensional settings. This is what the SIVA estimation literature does. The work of Xiaohong Chen, she does make the penalty vanish at the faster, and apparently you also did it, vanish at the faster rate, so that the biases, the regularization biases, disappear quickly enough, so that there's no effect from regularization. Asymptotically, and it's fine in moderately high dimensional settings. This is a great way to go, but in the high dimensional settings, I cannot afford to set the penalty level to be very low. Like for Lasso, I cannot set it lower than the penalty level that I described, like much lower than the penalty level that I described, because it will. The Lasso will start to select variables that are spurious predictors of Y and D, and it will mess up the estimation for different reasons. Yes, it's penalized minimum. It's penalized sieve minimum distance estimators paper. Is joint with Damien Poza. I think they have a sequence of papers where they do, like one paper appeared in Journal of Econometrics, another paper appeared in Econometrica, so they have a sequence of papers where they do this, yeah.
Thank you.
Interesting.